Let's begin with the big political story of the day. A week after swearing in as the Chief Minister of Punjab, Charanjit Singh Channi is all set to go ahead and name his team. The expansion of his government, that's going to be happening at 4:30 today. But ahead of the cabinet expansion, a fresh controversy has erupted. You've got six Congress MLAs and one former PCC chief writing a letter to the Punjab Congress chief, Navjot Singh Sidhu, to remove one of the names, to remove Rana Gurjit Singh from the proposed cabinet berth due to his involvement in alleged mining scandal, and instead include a clean Dalit face, according to these Congress MLAs, in view of the upcoming elections. Now, according to sources, the Congress MLAs to be inducted in CM Channi's cabinet have gotten the nod also of Congress MP Rahul Gandhi. Chief Minister Channi, along with Punjab Congress Chief Navjot Singh Sidhu, visited the national capital ahead of the cabinet expansion earlier in the week. Sources have revealed that 15 new ministers are likely to be inducted in this cabinet. Some of the names doing the rounds are Brahma Mohindra, Rana Gurjit, Manpreet Badal, Tript Rajinder Bajwa, Sukhbinder Singh Sarkaria, Aruna Chaudhary, Razia Sultana. They were all in the run for the cabinet expansion. Now, we've also learnt that some captain loyalists, interestingly, are likely to be dropped from the cabinet. Balbir Sidhu, Rana Gurmeet Sodhi, Gurpreet Singh Kangar and Sadhu Singh Dharamsot. They are all among those who are likely to be dropped.
चेहरा तो उन्होंने तय करना है, लोगों की इच्छा रहती है, सब नए चेहरे दिए हैं उन लोगों ने, वो चाहते हैं कि सब अपना अपना योगदान, इट्स अ टीम वर्क, मेरे को लगता है कि एक टीम के साथ होगा। सिद्धू साहब नेतृत्व करेंगे, प्रदेश कांग्रेस की कमान संभाले हुए हैं, पूरे प्रदेश में जाएंगे, एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिवली जो हमारे चन्नी साहब है वो देखेंगे, हम लोग नीचे जो अपने अपने कार्य और काम देखेंगे, एक सब जुड़कर, एक टीम जुड़कर एक नया इनकलाब पैदा करेगी और नया नई बात करेगी।
So while we get you the latest on the big updates coming in from Punjab, we're also tracking very closely the political developments in Uttar Pradesh. Ahead of the all-important assembly polls, which is slated to happen in 6 months from now, UP Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath will be expanding his cabinet this evening at 5:30 p.m. In a mammoth bid to include various caste groups and do a balancing act with all the allies as well, at least 7 to 8 ministers could be inducted in the cabinet rejig is what we're being told. Brahmin face Jitin Prasada, backward caste faces like Sangeeta Bhind, Chatrapal Gangwar, Paltu Ram, Dinesh Khatik and Krishna Paswan could take oath as ministers in Yogi Adityanath's cabinet. Now, the expansion will focus on unrepresented castes and also recent allies. The BJP recently struck alliances with the Nishad party apart from Apna Dal earlier. The Yogi government has 53 ministers, including 23 cabinet ministers, 9 ministers of state, independent charge, and 21 ministers of state at present. All discussions on the subject have reportedly been held with Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, as well as other senior UP BJP leaders. This includes the state BJP chief, Swatantrata Dev, and General Secretary Sunil Bansal. Governor Anandiben Patel, meanwhile, has rushed to Lucknow. So all eyes will be on this cabinet expansion, perhaps the most crucial so far for the BJP in Uttar Pradesh, the timing of which is very important. It's coming in the run-up to the elections. With just months to go, the BJP will be hoping for an equation that works out to their favour in every manner, whether it's the caste equation or the allies. Abhishek Mishra is joining us with more details on this. Abhishek, good afternoon. Just give us a sense of really what you're picking up about the cabinet expansion. Who in all likelihood will be inducted? Who's going to be accommodated? Because the messaging behind this cabinet expansion is something everyone's going to be watching out for.
Well, absolutely, Akshita, is going to be a very important day as far as the expansion is concerned. BJP was looking at this expansion from quite a while now. And, you know, earlier also there was a lot of buzz and it came very close. But this time it's the final call in the evening around 5:30 to 6 p.m. This induction will happen. Governor Anandiben Patel is going to swear in these MLAs and other candidates who are very likely to take the oath. I'm going to tell you 7 names which have emerged. Sangeeta Bhind, Jitin Prasad, Chatrapal Gangwar, पलटू राम, दिनेश खटीक, संजय गौड़ एंड धनवीर राजपाल. दीज आर द सेवन नेम्स विच हैज इमर्ज्ड एज द प्रोमिनेंट कैंडिडेट्स. द बीजेपी हैज वर्कड ऑन द कास्ट अरिथमेटिक, हैव गिवन रिप्रेजेंटेशन बाय फ्रॉम द ओबीसीज टू खटीक टू ब्राह्मण एज जतिन इज कंसर्न एंड अदर कैंडिडेट्स एज वेल. एंड एट द सेम टाइम दिस गोना बी द इंडक्शन ऑल्सो लाइकली टू बी द अनाउंसमेंट फॉर द एमएलसी नॉमिनेशन फॉर विच देर आर फोर नेम्स विच आर ऑलरेडी आउट. जितिन प्रसाद, संजय निषाद, गोपाल अंजान भुर्जी एंड वीरेंद्र गुर्जर. सो वी कैन सर्टनली से विद दीज नेम्स इट लुक्स लाइक दैट बीजेपी हैज डन देयर होमवर्क. दे नो विच एरिया एंड विच कास्ट एंड विच सेगमेंट इज नीड्स टू बी टेकन इन टू कंसिडरेशन एज फार एज 2022 बैटल इज कंसर्न. दिस कैबिनेट एक्सपेंशन इज इन टर्म्स ऑफ वर्क इज नॉट गोना हैव मच इम्पैक्ट, बट as far as going into the election is concerned and the representation of every segment and caste, it's going to be the main target. That's the reason that such names have emerged which was not coming earlier, and it is quite unexpected. At the same time, I would like to tell you that Jatin Prasad is on the way to Lucknow. Governor Anindiben Patel has reached Lucknow. The preparations are underway, and in the evening around 5:30 this important ceremony is going to happen where these new minister will be taking the oath.
Yes. All right, 5:30 is when we're expecting their expansion, and we will get you all the latest updates as and when they come in and the names being finalized. For the moment, Abhishek, thank you very much for joining us on this broadcast. We're getting you now a news break with regards to the investigation into the demise of Mahant Narendra Giri. India Today has now accessed Mahant Narendra Giri's will. This will mentions Balbir Giri clearly as his successor. Balbir was also mentioned as the successor in the suicide note that was found along with Mahant Giri's body. So clearly Balbir Giri has been named in the will and also in the suicide note. We're also picking up at this point that the Central Bureau of Investigation has kicked off its investigation, its probe in this death case, after just a few days ago the UP government had handed over the case formally to the CBI. And Home Minister Amit Shah today held a meeting on left-wing extremism in Delhi. The meeting was held to discuss the current status as well as the future roadmap for security and development issues. Maharashtra Chief Minister Uddhav Thackeray, Bihar Chief Minister Nitish Kumar, the Odisha Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik, Madhya Pradesh CM Shivraj Singh Chauhan, all of them were present for the meeting. The Chief Ministers of 10 Naxal-affected states, including Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Bihar, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Bengal, Uttar Pradesh, Kerala, Madhya Pradesh, all of their representatives were in fact apprising Amit Shah about the current situation in their states and the progress of development projects. Interestingly, many of the chief ministers from some of these states chose to skip and send representatives instead. BJP ally JDU has again raised the issue of caste census. Piling pressure on the ally, the BJP, Bihar Chief Minister Nitish Kumar says caste census is a necessity while urging the centre to go ahead and conduct the same. Nitish said that all parties of Bihar will meet again to re-strategise on the caste census issue. It's been a conundrum of sorts for the BJP, especially because their own allies like the JDU are putting pressure on them to go ahead and ensure a caste census is done. We've also seen all Bihar political parties, interestingly, coming together, keeping aside their political differences to push this demand forward.
जो जातीय जनगणना की बात हम लोगों ने कही है वो बिल्कुल उचित कहा है और उसका तर्क है और उसके बारे में उसका जो लाभ सबको मिलने वाला है, इन सब चीजों की हम लोगों ने चर्चा की है. अब ये जो कोर्ट का मामला है, सोशियो इकोनॉमिक कास्ट सेंसस से संबंधित मामला, अब उसके सिलसिले में सारी बातें आई है, तो इसका उससे कोई संबंध नहीं है. हम तो यही आग्रह करेंगे कि इस चीज पर ठीक ढंग से विचार करके, पुनर्विचार करके जिसको जातिगत जनगणना कराया जाए.
Let's move on to some other stories this Sunday. Days after a bloody shootout at a courtroom in Delhi, two accused have been arrested. One of the arrested accused has been identified as Umang Yadav, and he's an aide of gangster Tilu Tajpuria. India Today learns that it was Tillu who had ordered the elimination of rival Jitendra while being lodged in Delhi's Mandoli jail. Umang told investigators that he's been associated with Tillu Tajpuria for 2 years now. He revealed that he got a call from the gangster and was told that two people will come to his house and with their help, he will have to go ahead and kill Jitendra. Umang, an LLB dropout, drove the two shooters, dropped them off at the Rohini court premises, and they were all, of course, disguised as lawyers. The probe has revealed that the initial plan was that Umang will wait inside the car till the two shooters return. But when the plan failed, Umang fled from the scene. Police have arrested another person named Vinay, who, according to sources, disposed of the clothes and mobile phones of these attackers. Welcome back. Prime Minister Modi is back in India. He landed in the national capital to a rousing welcome. The red carpet was rolled out for Prime Minister Modi, who touched down at Delhi's Palam Airport. A sea of supporters gathered at the airport to welcome the Prime Minister back home after a historic three-day visit to the United States. Dance, music, garlands and greetings were in order for the Prime Minister. BJP party chief JP Nadda was also there to personally receive Prime Minister Modi. He heaped praises on the Prime Minister's successful visit to the United States, adding that Prime Minister Modi has put India and its issues on the global map. Prime Minister Modi soon after thanked supporters for the big welcome. He had, of course, a packed schedule with a series of important meetings, including his maiden bilateral with US President Joe Biden. He also took part in the Quad Summit, delivered a powerful speech at the United Nations General Assembly. Prime Minister Modi, in fact, clocked 20 meetings in a 65-hour stay in the United States. So all in all, a very important visit.
5 days ki yatra, bahut hi choti yatra thi. Lekin wo pure hi vyastata ke saath, engagements ke saath, और वहां के समाज के सभी लोगों के जो देश और दुनिया में राजनीति में मायने रखते हैं उनके साथ उनकी मुलाकात उनकी बातचीत हुई है और देश के करोड़ों लोगों की तरफ से जो उन्होंने देश को गौरवान्वित किया है उसके लिए मैं आप सब की ओर से उनका पुनः हार्दिक अभिनंदन करता हूं
भारत माता की भारत माता की आप सबका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद नमस्कार
And Prime Minister Modi, one of the big highlights of his three-day-long jam-packed US tour was that he's brought back to India 157 artifacts handed over to him by the United States during his visit. Now, these artifacts include a diverse set of items ranging from a bronze Nataraja from the 10th Common Era, copper anthropomorphic objects from the 2000 BC to the terracotta vase from the 2nd Common Era. These pieces also include figurines of Hindu deities like Lakshmi Narayana, Buddha, Vishnu, Shiva Parvati and religious sculptures. All the artifacts given to Prime Minister Modi largely belong to the period of 11th Common Era to the 14th. Out of the 157 antique pieces, 71 are cultural, 60 figurines belong to Hinduism, 16 from Buddhism and 9 from Jainism. These artifacts were stolen and now they've been returned to where they belong, to India. Both Biden and Prime Minister Modi also made commitments to strengthening efforts to combat theft, illicit trade and trafficking of important cultural objects. And my colleague Sneha Murdani also spoke to Vijay Kumar, the co-founder of India Pride Project, which has been engaged in identifying Indian cultural objects that have been stolen and smuggled overseas.
We're now being joined by Vijay Kumar, co-founder of India Pride Project. He and his team were behind identifying countless Indian treasures stolen and smuggled overseas. Vijay and his team helped Prime Minister Narendra Modi get back the artifacts from America to India. Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Vijay. I want to begin by asking you, and of course, congratulations first. How did you really manage to arrange the return of these artifacts, and what is the process been like? How do you feel today when the government has put out the list of these artifacts that are coming back to the country along with the Prime Minister?
Thanks again for covering us. We've been on this since 2007. So most of these artifacts have been under the radar, being smuggled out of India, taken from temples, many from archaeological sites all over India. So this is not a problem that was specific to a particular state. And I think India First has to thank the New York District Attorney Office, Colonel Bokranos. And there's a wonderful lady of Indian origin there, Apsara, who has been very, very instrumental in working this from the US side. So what happens basically is most of the artifacts that are coming back are linked to the Subhash Kapoor case. But then there are many more that are linked to others that are looted from temples and sites in India, some going back as early as 1970 and 1960s. And what is historic about this particular restitution of 165 odd objects is that, to put things in perspective, India from independence, say till 2000, had restituted only 19 artifacts. And from 2000 to 2012, India had got back zero. So if you're going to put a timeline for the objects or motis that have been gotten back into India, artifacts, till 2012, India as a whole had brought back 19. And that was something that our team was working on with a lot of agencies, both in India and law enforcement worldwide, especially the US side, in providing inputs about thefts. Some of these thefts were never reported. So we have a volunteer-driven program wherein we have volunteers all over the world who are capturing data about new acquisitions of museums. We ask people to help photograph anything that comes for sale, and also have volunteers all over the world taking photographs of exhibits that are in museums, along with what we call provenance papers, basically which year this artifact was acquired by the museum.
Will these artifacts, Mr. Vijay, go back to their places of origin, like Eastern India and so as mentioned, or will they be set up in a different sort of a museum? What's the plan next?
Most of them, we would like at least the motis that are coming back to go back to the temples. And this has already happened. For example, in the case of the Rama, Lakshmana and Sita that came back from London 2 years ago, they have been very well protected by the local communities in Anandamangalam. And worship has restarted. In fact, the village itself has been galvanized. So we sincerely hope that we take care of our murtis and make sure that they are not stolen again. But once they are well documented, it will be very difficult to steal them again. But most important, they should go back to worship. It should not be that they go from one museum to another museum. But that leaves out the rest of it, the objects that are basically taken from historical sites. They were objects, basically fragments, broken items, terracotta objects, mostly from Chandraketuga. We hope they go back to at least the state or the district, and there should be local museums. More importantly, the state should start investigating. So many thefts have happened, objects have left the particular state. Sadly, despite all these objects that are coming back, very few cases have been registered, mostly only in Tamil Nadu. We hope all these objects coming back will help. I think this case of, I think most of us have missed out the case of the Barud Yakshi that is going to come back to us, seized from Subhash Kapoor in 2012. She will go down in history as the most expensive restituted object ever coming back to India. She was being sold in the market for 85 crore rupees. And she was taken from a farmer's Kuladevata temple. She was robbed and she's 2,200 years old. And we hope such restitutions spur a fresh round of criminal proceedings against the robbers. Because right now we are just reinstating murtis. The network is still active.
And with that exclusive, it's a wrap on this broadcast. Thank you very much for watching. I'm leaving you with this footage of the Indian Air Force holding an air show after 13 years over Srinagar's picturesque Dal Lake. The air show was held as part of ongoing celebrations commemorating Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. We're leaving you with these images. Thank you for watching. Oh,
Allah.